Hello everyone, this is Cloey. It's nice to be here again, and I decided that I would like to participate in April with Arwen's tarot tag. I guess she's called... I guess she's called Arwen the Professional Joy Seeker. I really like her videos. Nice to be on here, Arwen. I saw that there was 10 questions, and I want to just get right into it and get it going, and yeah, so here we go. I wasn't able to participate in the initial tag 15. I was still on meds and muscle relaxer for my jaw, so I was really out of it, so I'm looking forward to participate in this, just for the fun of it. So here we go. The first question is, what is your primary reason for pulling out your cards? Well, I've been a bit of a semi-professional hobbyist of tarot and oracles for a number of years now. I say hobbyist because I mostly did fundraisers and kind of events where I would get tipped occasionally, and I did do some paid gigs every now and again, but nothing steady. Just really enjoyed being of service. Plus, I'm an ordained reverend, so I did a lot of readings for a while based off of a service. One of the ways that pagans seek counsel is to see a reader, and if you're a spiritual practitioner of service to your community in a priest or priestess or reverend or minister way, you can add on oracle reading / tarot / oham / you know, runes as your way of doing something almost like spiritual counseling. Not in a fully professional way. I guess some people might say, yes, you've been a professional. But to me, it's always been kind of a hobby / part of my priestesshood, my druidess / priestesshood. So there you go. So for me, my primary reason for pulling out my cards is to be of service on one level. But the other thing is I love the art and the creativity and just the beauty you can find in all these wonderful card decks and stuff. Now, when I work with runes or the Oham, it's a bit different. It's connecting with my ancestry and my spiritual roots and things like that. I have Celtic ancestry. I have Scandinavian / German ancestry. So Viking and whatnot in my ancestry, and I really felt drawn to connect to my spiritual roots in that way. And divination was one of the first methods that I came into when I moved from, or when I released my Christian spirituality. I had always had a connection with nature, but anyways, that's a whole nother conversation. Let's just say for me, my primary reason has been to be of service to the community. The other would be, and it's a very, very strong one, would be that I love the creativity, the artwork, the methods that people create divination systems with, and I just love to explore and see what's in there. I love the artwork, Jasmine Beckett Griffith, so many others, Selena Finch, Jennifer somebody, I can't remember her name, another fairy artist, Brian Froud. Oh, my cats are acting up again. Come on, you guys, be nice. So yeah, and I love the theme. Being able to study other cultures through divination is so fascinating. So to me, it's a way of learning more about the world and being able to explore different aspects of myself, but the art is really important. So I'll end with that and move on to the next question. All right. So do I use tarot in any other way than reading? I have to say yes. As a reverend for my pagan church back in Utah, I would bring my cards. Sometimes we would do a divination, but often I would use, say, my theme decks, like say my animal oracles, druid animal oracles, my plant oracles, my sacred world oracle, which is another animal oracle. I think I had the animals divine tarot or divine animals tarot. Love that one. It's awesome for being able to have cards out representing animal totems, plant totems, or allies, and other gods and goddesses with animal energy mixed in. And so I love to use tarot as, if I don't have statuary, I use them as artworks that represent the spirit allies, deities, and totems that we work with in our spiritualities. And for our rituals, for crafting, for whatever. Also, within the artwork, I'm really, really drawn to triskels and triple spirals and double-tailed mermaids and all kinds of cool things like that. And I got inspiration for my tattoo that I had wanted for several years from a combined artwork that I'd seen on tarot and also my research into Celtic and Northern European cultures. So that was a springboard. Another way that I've used tarot other than reading is I've used my, I guess I shouldn't say tarot, I mean card divination sets, I would say, is... The you hardly ever see the Roman numerals anywhere except for, say, in your math class that you get taught every now and then in school, right? Sometimes you see it in chapter books. Sometimes you see it in, like, title type things. Unless you're able to visit, like, old Roman archaeological or, you know, those kinds of sites, scientific sites and things like that. You don't really see a lot of it every day in your life. So when my kids got to a certain section of suggested, you know, different levels of reading, we homeschool. So one of the curriculum list was to go over Roman numerals. And when we came to that, I was like, aside from books, where are my kids going to see Roman numerals? Because I live in America. It's not something you see every day. Now, if you can think of places to see, like, aside from, I mean, there's the occasional library and sometimes a museum. You really don't see Roman numerals all the time. So I have an oracle deck, and so do you all, the tarot. Many of them have Roman numerals, but usually they only go to about 22. The normal minor arcana doesn't usually carry Roman numerals, although I think there are some that do use them. But on average, at least the wider weight types don't necessarily have the minor arcana filled with, Roman numerals, and even if they did, it'd be like the 1 through 10, right? So my sacred world oracle, which is actually an animal oracle, has the Roman numerals all the way up to 44, which I hadn't even known, like really had it memorized firmly in my head, what the upper level Roman numeral digits were. So I've used oracles / divination systems and tarot to study for homeschooling with my two boys, for learning Roman numerals, animals, studying animals, and then slashing that into kind of a mythology and cultural blend of knowledge of animals in general. And we haven't gotten too much into the plants, but I'm expecting that to come up soon because they wanted to learn about safe plants, edible plants, and other things. And I have a plant oracle, but I'll probably have to look into some other ones. I just love the art, and I think it's done so well to show such great detail that I'm going to access my oracles and divination tools to help teach things in a visual way because I have visual learners. And they like hands-on learning too. So instead of just reading a book, we're going to access visual illustrations with them. Okay. If I use tarot as part of my magical practice, can I share some examples? Well, I've done a little bit of sharing as a reverend, using it within ritual from a focus and meditation, representing the allies within a ritual space so people can focus on them while we're trying to connect with them. Let's see, I've also, when you work with the runes, I actually have been trying to build up my repertoire for using runes and divination. I more work with my runes for spell work, crafts, and things like that for sigil type stuff. And I use my Ohem a bit for both. I've used them within divination. I do have a rune deck called the Visions Rune or something. It's not the most popular form of rune card system, but I have that one, and I've used that occasion for themed sabbats that where they had a lot of Viking or whatever, Scandinavian or German feel to the event. Like, I went to a bloat and I did divination for them there. Probably not traditional, but they liked seeing the artwork, so it was kind of fun. So yeah, for my magical practice, I will use it to help with connecting with certain symbols. I'm not a big person for meditation. I can talk people through a meditation, but as for doing the meditation myself, journey meditations don't really work for me. I more breathe through colors and symbols and allow that to sink into my currents and see where that takes me. And then I try to be visually aware of my space to see if any of the symbols are coming to me. And in that way, I feel that spirit talks to me, be it Mother Earth or the allies or what have you of the triple realms. So yeah, I use it in that sense. I was trying to think if there was anything more specific. I do sort of a similar thing for myself, where if I don't have statuary or something, even stuffed animals or whatever, I will use my divination, my oracles, well, my animal oracles and my fae oracles or whatever, to be representations on my altar or my ritual space out in nature. A deck can be a nice portable representation of what you want to focus on, although I do mostly try to focus on nature when I'm out in nature. But per se, I'm going to a spot that I haven't been before, and I want to check to make sure that I am, that the landscape's consciousness, that the land or the beach or the creek or whatever is willing to work with me on my purpose that I went there for. I will do a divination before I even start a ritual or setup or anything, because I want to make sure that I'm not pushing my currents and my goals onto the space or the consciousness of the local loke or spiritual essence of a natural place. Or even the park or whatever I want to get a reading on, if it's a safe place to be doing spiritual work without, you know, drawing attention in a negative way, possible altercation or anything like that. I like to do a divination to see if it is a good day, location, time, whatever, to get a feel for if it will go well or if I should maybe reschedule or whatnot. Or be aware that there might be some conflict. And then make my choice from there. It is considered a somewhat druidic practice to do that, to tune into your space that you want to work in and make sure that you're, that the location is aligned with your goals and is open to having you do your activity within their space, within their beingness. So yeah, that's another way I use it for ritual. And as part of my magical practice, I have done even a few spells occasionally using oracles or tarot. So yeah, I've used it in several different ways. How do you explain what tarot is when someone asks you? As soon as it's well-meaning. Well, that depends. I've done a lot of like mini readings at say like psychic fairs or fundraisers, which are kind of like slash psychic fairs and other things going on. I've also done paid gigs where I was reading for, say, a university's hospital party called, I did a winter one a few years in a row. I got re-invited back for about 3 or 4 years, called Frostfest back in Utah when they were doing that. And we'd had to do these really fast, intense reading. So when you do that, you don't have time to tell people, okay, this is what tarot is. I usually do something more along the lines of, oh, you know, the Oracle of Delphi. Well, tarot is a set system that kind of does that kind of thing. You know, I do something really quick. I've changed that story a little bit over there. You know, I'm not a medium per se, but I am a sensitive. And I sometimes just say, I use this system of Oracle, be it tarot or Lenormand or something else, to help organize the current that I feel from you, to tell a story instead of having bits and pieces come at me all willy-nilly and it being kind of out of order. The cards help put it into an organized story that we can talk about and share and help you work through things. And that is usually pretty good for most people. And that kind of think, I think, nope, it doesn't lead me into one of the questions, but it kind of is part of my answer for one of the questions. I think I'll see as we go. Okay, so number four. Number five, what is your favorite spread to use and why? Mostly, I do have maybe, if I use a spread, I have a handful that I like. I don't do the Celtic cross. I'd like to say that right out there. I am a non-Celtic cross person. I don't knock it for those who love it, but I do not love it. There's too much monotheistic kind of, the way that the questions and the setup of the Celtic cross are set up is too slanting towards a Christian perspective. I like to have spreads that are more based off the present and the people and not so inclined that way, let's put it that way. I think it can work really well for those who love it, and I've even had people do Celtic cross spreads for me, but I don't enjoy doing it for other people at all. I know it. Yeah. But I love freeform intuitive readings where I lay the cards down and I kind of let the current between me and the person flow, and my connection and interaction with, you know, the land, sea, and sky, the realms speak, you know, not, I don't hear voices. So for to me, it's more like feelings and physical feelings and how I feel connected to the space I am, the local loke, the consciousness of the space, and then the current of the person who's come to ask questions, the seeker. I like that. I do have kind of a almost a pentacle spread that I do, which is about five cards, and then I'll add to it if I need to for clarification. I do have a reverse pyramid that sometimes start off as that pentacle spread and then somehow turns into a reverse pyramid when I'm adding different layers, if it's getting into a bigger, longer, thicker reading. And yeah, it kind of goes from like a past, present, future thing, and then we go down and kind of weave through the different issues till we get some advice or possibilities and so forth. And if you'd like to see a video on that, I could try to run through an example reading to show you how that works. And then I showed, actually, I did, I showed some of that in my 31 Days of Tarot with Ethany earlier in January. So maybe in the description below, I'll add a link to that day and you guys can see that at least some of the spreads are, because the next one I'm pretty sure that I did do. It's the Triskel spread I created. Yeah, I don't want to go into that too deep, but it's my creation and I don't do it all the time, but it is a spread I created because I tend to do the more intuitive one most of the time anyways. So I do have some older spreads that I still have friends that use those spreads, but I don't necessarily use the spreads anymore. They use it, but I stopped a while back. It's like a diamond spread. I think I may have even gotten it from some other deck, but then I tweaked it a bit, and I have friends that use it now with multiple decks instead of, yeah. I kind of help them tweak it to be a little bit more in-depth for them. But yeah, I tend to go with how I'm feeling in the moment, and then I intuitively allow the questions and spread and the interaction to direct me which cards I should read together and what order. And I feel that since I started studying the Lenormand, how I work with my other oracles, including Tarot and whatnot, has trained me more on blending different cards in different directions. So yeah, it's kind of a cross method now. And I'll let that go at that. I will try to remember to link or put the link down in the description. Okay. Name a famous currently living person who embodies one of the following cards for you. The Hermit, Star, Justice, just one card, one person is fine. The first person who came to my head, and I guess as a Star or Justice, because there's been so much in the media that I don't really pay a lot of attention, but I've always admired Angelina Jolie. We were actually pregnant during the same time, so she was kind of on my mind during that time period. And so when I hear stuff about Angelina Jolie, I pay attention to it because we're around the same age. So yeah, she I would think of as a star or justice because she's been in legal court, I guess a divorce with her husband and custody issues with Brad Pitt. So yeah, that's what I'm reminded of when I think of those cards. And I don't know if she embodies it. I mean, as a star, as a famous person with hope and showing possibilities and a real seeker of moving forward and really activating what she wants in her life, I could totally see her as a star. Justice, just because of her life experiences. And she's also known for being drawing awareness and trying to help those children from third world countries who are needing assistance. So yeah, I see aspects of her there. So there you go. Number seven, have you ever read in a crowded, noisy, chaotic environment, and how did it go for you? Okay, let me tell you this. I am known for being a reader in all those kinds of situations. I do booth events like Pagan Pride. I do New Consciousness Expo, or I did in the past. I'm checking out Pagan Pride. It doesn't seem very local here. I think the closest one is over in Tacoma or something like that. And I'm in Olympia, so we'll see. I don't know. But my point is I actually love booth events. I love, say, like the psychic fairs and the fundraisers where I'm doing mini readings and taking care of a lot of people. I don't like going to those events as just a participant of the event. I prefer to be of service in those events. Noisy, chaotic situations. If I am not busy in my zone, I will be having migraine headaches the whole time. I don't even go to bars unless I know I'm going to be really, really drunk or being of service. If I'm being of service, something about being in the zone and opening to spirit energizes me. And if as long as I stay in the flow, I feel really good, except from eventually, if it's a long event, my voice box will start trying to give out. And I have a little bit of that jaw thing. I think I inherited it from my grandmother. I think TMJ or something else, especially with my experience with my mouth not too long ago, because of my root canal and such. Yeah, I have to be careful how long I talk, but I'm much a chatterer, so it all balances out, I feel. My boys will be like, oh yeah, mom's gonna be like really mellow for like a week and need to relax after her event. So yeah, so it's kind of funny. But so yes, I actually the only way I can enjoy a chaotic environment, noisy environment, is if I'm being of service, which for me means having a reading table. Now, when I went to Newt's, I kind of wish that. I mean, I was busy enough going to the presentations and I wasn't in a really loud area too much. It was really good. I was able to handle it as I'm just so used to being part of bigger events where it's loud and just, oh, everybody everywhere and just chaos and everything. And I really didn't feel like that about Newt's. Yeah, there was the night of the dinner that was kind of loud because of the belly dancing and the stereo music. But aside from that, and I had the option of alcohol during that time, so I was able to have just one or two drinks, enough to help me feel really mellow and able to just flow with whatever was happening. So yeah, I usually don't choose to participate in very rowdy, loud events unless I know, like I said, that I can be offering readings or, yeah, the other way around. So I guess I answer questions. And as for how it goes for me, I also find one thing, I get very energized during these events if I'm in service. When I have flow going, I can just keep going and going and going like an Energizer bunny. Like I said, the only thing that stops me after a while is my voice box giving out. Otherwise, when spirit and I have a wide open tap, it's just flowing, flowing, flowing. So if you're one of those kind of people, I'd love to hear about it. Where I've met so many people that tell me these events drain them or overwhelm them or whatever. And I'm just like, really? Because it really, I feel like I'm riding a wave when I'm participating. All right. So yeah, I actually like it. Although I've never done, until I did a radio event, it was a radio sponsored, like women's night out, and then I think we did like a Valentine's Day or a Mother's Day thing where they got to come and like chill out and do all kinds of stuff. They had really loud music. It was just an vendors event. But then when I did this other one that they offered, the same radio station, it added a second event, and I went to 2 years of that. And it was like a stand up, do karaoke, had like a cafe eating area, and then there was also a bar. So that was the closest I got to doing bar readings, Arwen's. And I enjoyed it. I had a lot of fun. So let's see. Next question. Almost getting to the end. Do you do any type of ritual, meaning repetitive, do it every time, or spiritual? Ritual. Okay, before I read. Okay, so for me, setup and even the things I do before I even get to the reading is kind of important. When I know I'm going to be doing reading and I'm going to be, especially when I was acting as a reverend and helping run the ritual for the day and all those kind of stuff, and maybe still, or even our psychic fair events that we did for the church or for other fundraisers that I participated in. I would do a special cleanse, be it a salt, sea salt, scrub wash ahead of time that day or the night before, depending on what my time frame of availability was. And then how I set up my reading space is part of that ritual that I do before reading. Now, if I feel that the person who's sitting down is really nervous or kind of like unfocused, I will take a moment to, ground with either one of my stones or do a breathing technique and even ask the person, okay, let's take a focus, a couple of breaths. And while you're doing the breathing, try to focus your question or think about how you want to share what you want to look into. And then I start. And I always, sometimes I verbally, but mostly internally, I ask the land, sea, and sky allies to come closer and help with clarifying and flowing the seeker's current with me so that I can get a clear messages through for the person and that we are protected and the good spirits are nearby, keeping negativity or helping to help the seeker release anything that they don't need to be hanging on to. Okay, so yeah, I do that. And like I said, when it comes to my setup, that could be a big part of it. Like what stones, I like to have shells and kind of a water theme going on my reading table. Unless I'm at a themed event and they require a certain look, I tend to have a few shells. I really like water pebbles, like I mentioned, shells. And I even have a sea, ocean water vial or a sea water vial. Whenever I can get to the ocean, and now I live right by the bay. So it used to be when I was in Utah, I could only get to the ocean every once a year or every other year. So then I would exchange out the old water and grab some new water and with fresh ocean water, use it in my readings and rituals. So that's what I would do. And so keeping some kind of fresh water or water nearby is very important to me, be it the shells or stones or whatever. I love ocean jasper or agate. I feel it has a very cleansing, welcoming energy that can also be very healing and soothing for the seeker. But I feel like it can also be energizing depending on how I tap in with it. So those are some things I focus on at kind of in a ritualistic way when I'm beginning a reading or helping the person calm and focus for the reading. Draw a card to answer this question. What is my next best step, universe? What is my next best step? Okay, so I have the good tarot out. We'll see what it has for me. Ooh, got a jumper. Ooh, got an ace of air. That's nice. Beginning of communication, thoughts, new beginnings, possibly. Let's see what else. Always pay attention to the jumper, but I want to know. I know that mentally I'm setting up for my next event, and I've been working out some fun schooling journals and curricula that I have to order now. So we'll see. What do you have to say? This, I'm finding the gautreaux a bit large for my hands. I mean, technically, it isn't that large, like how wide it is and all that, but how thick it is on the cardstock that you get with an Oracle deck is a bit large for my small hands. So that's what I'm talking about. All right. Ooh, the Queen of Earth mixed with the Ace of Fire. That is a very interesting combination. Well, again, I'm still kind of being pulled towards how I'm trying to put things together right now, organize things. We're kind of in a little mini restart in school and towards the end of the homeschool year. Actually, I recently decided to do year-round homeschool, and I let the kids know about that just this weekend slash Monday, and they were a little. I was like, "Look, we're gonna have weeks off. We are, but we're gonna do like so many weeks on, 1 week off. So many weeks on, 1 week off, to offset that, so they don't feel like they're in school all the time." But that was a bit of an announcement, and I was letting them pick out stuff. So we're doing some reorganization. I know I'm also putting my projects on here, the things I'm putting together for the YouTube channel, and really trying to stay focused and active and not let things kind of slide. So mentally, the Ace of Air, I'm definitely going to be thinking about this card for a little bit to see how it's applying to the stuff that I'm working with right now. But I also love there is a Pegasus on this card, and I have always loved the Pegasus from that old movie, Clash of the Titans, I think. I love that horse. That horse had so much spunk and character. I really feel that mentally I'm more uplifted now than I have been, especially with my health issues that were going on for a bit there. And I want to be as beneficial for others when it comes to services or whatever else that I'm doing. I'm finding that I'm being guided to help start some activities and events within my homeschooling community, let alone what I'm trying to get started with in more spiritual and services space stuff. So yeah, can see a lot of new beginning type stuff with air. And then having the Queen of Earth come in, that's that whole, I'm a homeschooling mom, I'm a stay-at-home mom, I'm trying to get all this stuff and just this things that have been coming of me kind of stepping forward and starting some activity and group kind of stuff for my kids and other things that I'm thinking about getting going here that I'm hoping others will like to participate in. I can see how these cards line up with that. Also, I just learned in the last year or two, I think it was in the last year and a half. My friend Lee of Elemental Inspirations, she was doing some hand-drawn natal charts with some specialized astrology books that helped clarify my moon in my chart. I had always felt my chart was a little bit off, like I didn't quite match my combination. I'm a Pisces sun, and for years I thought I was like a Gemini moon, but she did my chart and she's like, "Oh no, honey, your moon is on that little cuspy time." And according to my, she had like updated books or something that was more accurate than what you can get with a computer program. It said I had a Taurus moon instead. And when I read Pisces sun with Taurus moon description of the personality and kind of stuff that you. There was like only one thing that was a discrepancy, whereas half of everything on the other one was always off. This had like one thing that I didn't quite key in with it. Everything else was, it was like me with maybe a twin aspect that I don't have a twin, but if I had a twin, she would have had that other aspect. So it was very exciting to learn about that. So to see the Queen of Earth come up, I'm very connected to the earth, although I feel much more connected to. I don't know, water. That's why I work with the realms, because I feel like the realms of land, sea, and sky are the physical realms and spiritual realms of reality and spirituality, and the fire is the blender. So when I see the earth of Queen of Earth right now, it reminds me of that aspect of myself that I kind of always felt was kind of there, how I always was the more stable sibling or relation in my family that helped with all kinds of stuff. But I was also very flighty and Pisces. You know, a Pisces can be very flighty and unorganized, but Yeah, so I see some stuff going on there. And Queen of Earth, yeah, taking on the responsibilities, really being stepping up to help in the family realm and being doing my part within the family. And yep, I definitely see that. And I'm going to spend some time walking through some stuff with those two cards to really take that in. If you have any ideas of what it could mean, please feel free to leave a comment. I love to hear other people's interpretations of the tarot cards. And this one's kind of oracular, so I might even go into the book that came with it and see what it says about Ace of Air and Queen of Earth. I'm sure it has some good stuff. All right, I want to just go ahead and finish up the last question since this has gone on so long. I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to take this long. I was trying to do it a little quicker. Get to talking and it gets out of control, right? All right, so how do you think you can personally improve your reading skills? Well, I kind of mentioned that. I didn't quite. I talked a little bit more about my homeschool stuff, didn't I? When it comes to reading skills, I'm more of a hands-on type. I'm not a journaler. I mean, I do notebook notes and stuff like that, but not in like an organized set notebook for, say, just tarot or just spiritual work or whatever. I've tried doing that and it never really gets going. I usually have just like a general notebook. I might divide it into sections of like daily notes and things that I'm taking care of for health stuff or going to the library or homeschool stuff or, oh, I'm studying this oracle and I want to do this spread. Let me just mark down some of the cards I pulled in this time so I can go look it up in the book and see how I'm feeling about what's blending on here. But I don't have set books for different things. Matter of fact, I was just thinking I needed to get a proper at website address and password books. I don't have it in so many different little notebooks, you know? So yeah. Something about organizing how I do my studies, I would think, is part of it. And also how I'm helping my children study. That wouldn't help improve my reading skills. And I'm having to make peace with the fact that I am an oracle reader more than a tarot or a set system type reader because I've been really drawn to study the Ohm, and I can do readings with the Ohm, especially since I've gotten, oh yeah, I'm really spending some time right now with this deck. I'm hoping to get it a bit more under my, sorry, I moved my leg. Oh, you guys, please get along. The Voices of the Trees. This is actually my second Ohm set that has a similar name like that. I think my other one's a disc set that has like the leaves of the trees with the Ohm symbol on the disc. And I can read that far better than just having the symbols. So I'm working through that. And this set has, like, as you know, if you've seen this deck, has really awesome portraits and so much nice symbolism mixed in that I feel like I'm really going to be able to read the Ohm without feeling, ooh, do I need to look up the meanings, that kind of stuff. So I'm focusing on that. And I really miss my intuitive and divination group that I used to meet. It was like once a month or once to twice a month. I think it was mostly once a month. But I was getting confused because I had some other groups that were starting to do some divination groups back in Utah. And it was like, how many groups do you guys need in the area, right? But hey, if there's enough demand, you find your clan and you start meeting up and gather, you know? So I used to bring my new decks or whatever system I was studying and plus my ones that I had down pat, like my Druid Animal Oracle. And I would do practice readings with people, not just me reading, but them reading me, everybody reading each other, offering ideas and all this kind of stuff of things to try to explore different types of intuitive gifts and let them have a safe practice space they can run through and have, a space of trust, a willingness to be open to new ideas and trying new things, sharing our pretties and just oohing and aahing over the artwork or the divination style that somebody was interested in. Or if it isn't divination, then perhaps they have some intuitive gifts that they want to be able to try out and get it, have a practice space. We provided that with their intuitive and divinations group. We got to use our temple space. I got to help guide and be one of the people that came to guide and just be part of things. And I really enjoy it and I really miss my old community. Hey guys, if you're watching. I hope they continue on without me. But I think I might want to start something either locally here, physically where I'm at, or even start maybe a live stream or some kind of group aspect here online of doing intuitive and divination exploration and practices. So I was thinking that might be very helpful for improving my reading skills and also helping others improve their reading skills and just have a practice space for everybody. So that's an idea. And yeah, I think that's enough. This is so long already. I might have to re-record it and try to shorten it or something. So I hope you guys found some cool ideas within that, enjoyed the share. And Arwen, thank you so much for putting this challenge together. Whether or not I win, don't care. Love participating. Be awesome. I'm a little bit more interested in maybe doing one of your interviews because I think you're so wonderful and so funny. I love humor. So yeah, that's what I'm thinking about. So thank you for your time, and I hope they found this amusing. If you have any comments, I will read through them and get back to you. And I must put down the spreads in the description. Okay. Thanks. See ya. Peace out. Bye-bye.